Blood vessels are the conduits of our cardiovascular system, and what that means is they create a network of pipes inside our body that allows the movement of our blood. And that's important because blood carries not only nutrients, electrolytes, minerals, and vitamins, but it also carries hormones, waste products, and different types of cells to different parts of our body. Now, blood vessels come in three different types. We have arteries and we have veins and we also have capillaries. So let's begin by focusing on our artery. Now, arteries vary in size. The largest artery of our body is our aorta, and the smallest one is something called an arteriole. And we also have different sizes in between. Now, by definition, an artery is a blood vessel that always carries blood away from the heart and to the cells, the tissues, and organs of our body. And most of the time, our arteries carry blood that contains oxygen, so oxygenated blood. But sometimes, as in the case of the left and the right pulmonary artery, these actually carry deoxygenated blood away from the heart and specifically to the left and the right lung. Now, what about the structure? What about the anatomy of our artery? So let's take a cross section of the artery. We basically get the following diagram, and notice that the artery consists of three different layers. We have the innermost layer, the tunica intima, where tunica means layer and intima means inner. We have the mid layer, the tunica media, and we have the outer layer, the tunica externa. Now, what exactly is the function of each one of these layers? Well, notice this inside portion is the lumen. It's the internal cavity of the blood vessel, and this is where the blood actually flows. And so the tunica intima is actually in direct contact with the blood plasma. And so what that means is it contains a layer of endothelial cells that are responsible for absorbing the nutrients that the blood vessels actually need to function correctly and efficiently. Now, within the tunica intima, we also have a network of protein elastin fibers, and this basically gives our blood vessel the ability to actually be flexible, so have the ability to basically expand and stretch back. Now, the middle layer, this red layer, is our tunica media, and this is where the smooth muscle of the blood vessel is actually found. And in arteries, the tunica media is a thick layer. So arteries contain a thick layer of smooth muscle, and we'll see why that's important in just a moment. Now, the outer layer is our tunica externa, and this basically contains our collagen fibers. And collagen fibers give the blood vessels its strength, and these collagen fibers also anchor the blood vessel along the organs found surrounding our blood vessel. Now, what are some properties of our arteries, and how exactly does blood actually flow through the arteries? Well, as a result of a thick layer of smooth muscle, that makes the artery not only elastic and stretchy, but it also gives it very high recoil capabilities. So what that basically means is, as the blood actually flows through our blood vessel, through the artery slightly expands as a result of that increase in blood flow. But because it has a thick layer of smooth muscle, you can think of this as being a rubber band. When you stretch the rubber band, it wants to return back to place. And in the same way, because of this thick layer of smooth muscle, when you stretch the artery, it wants to return back into place. So it expands, but it quickly recoils, returns to place, and this is exactly how the blood actually flows through our arteries. Now, recall that smooth muscle is innervated by our autonomic nervous system. So it's the autonomic nervous system that actually controls the dilation and the contraction of our arteries. So the autonomic nervous system can basically control the blood pressure and the blood flow through our arteries, and that's important in our body. Now, finally, it also has a high resistance to blood flow because as soon as that blood enters our artery, it wants to recoil back into place. And so that creates a high resistance. And that's exactly why the ventricles of our heart have to create such a strong force, such a high hydrostatic pressure to move all that blood through these arteries that have a relatively high resistance. So when the ventricles contract, they fill our blood vessels, they fill the arteries. And as a result of the elastic nature of these blood vessels, it causes them to actually recoil. And when they recoil, that is exactly what moves that blood through the rest of our artery. So this is how blood flows inside the artery. Now, what about our veins? Well, just like arteries come in different sizes, veins also come in different sizes. The smallest vein is called a venule, and the largest vein in our body is called the vena cava. We have two. We have the inferior and the superior vena cava. Now, if our arteries actually carry blood away from the heart, then the veins always carry blood to the heart and away from the cells, the tissues, and organs of our body. Most of the time, veins carry deoxygenated blood, but sometimes, in the case of the left and the right pulmonary vein, they actually carry oxygenated blood to the left atrium of our heart. Now, what about the structure? What about the anatomy of the vein? So as it turns out, veins also have these same three layers. They have the tunica intima, the tunica media, and the tunica extrema. However, veins have a much thinner, they have a relatively thin tunica media layer, and that's because they have very few smooth muscles. So this layer here inside veins is relatively thick. So that's exactly why, unlike our arteries, the veins are not very elastic. In fact, we can assume they're inelastic, and that means they do not recoil the same way that our arteries recoil. And that's exactly why when the blood flows through our vein, when it expands, it remains in that shape because it doesn't have all that smooth muscle to recoil it back into place. So that's exactly why, unlike the arteries, these don't actually have such a high resistance, and they can expand and carry much more blood, much more volume of blood than our arteries. In fact, the veins together carry about 60 to 65% of the total volume of blood. The rest is carried by the capillaries, and a small portion is carried by our arteries, or a relatively small portion. Now, arteries actually have it pretty easy because when arteries expand from the heart and they travel to the bottom of the body, they are moving with the force of gravity. So in the same direction that the force of gravity actually acts. However, when those venules and veins leave the capillaries in the bottom portion of our body, they have to move up to the heart and against the force of gravity. The question is, what exactly allows the veins to move that blood against the force of gravity, and what keeps that blood from actually flowing back down those veins? Remember, veins do not actually have a thick layer of smooth muscle, so what allows that blood to move through our veins? Well, as it turns out, next to our veins are skeletal muscle, and we can actually voluntarily control our skeletal muscle. And that's exactly why when we move, when we run, when we swim, anytime we move our legs, that helps the movement of the blood inside our veins. That's one thing that assists the movement of our blood inside our vein. Now, what about the problem of that blood going back down the vein as a result of the force of gravity? Well, as it turns out, unlike the arteries, veins actually contain a system of valves. They have a system of one-way valves that prevents the backflow of blood inside the vein. So to see what we mean, let's take a look at the following diagram. So this is a simplified diagram of the vein. So we basically have our blood that is moving against the force of gravity. So the question is, what exactly prevents the blood from actually stopping and going back down? Well, we have these one-way valves in place. So they open up one way when that blood basically creates a pressure and acts against that valve. But if that valve decides to basically turn around and go back down, what basically stops it is the fact that these valves only open one way. As soon as that blood hits these portions of the valves will close as a result of that pressure, the force due to that blood. So that's exactly what prevents that blood from flowing back down our veins with the force of gravity. So we see that even though the veins have the same exact three layers as our arteries, the veins have a much thinner tunica media, and they also have this system of one-way valves in place to prevent the movement of our blood back down our vein as a result of the force of gravity. Now, what about the third type of blood vessel, our capillaries? Well, capillaries are actually very, very tiny blood vessels. They're the smallest blood vessels found inside our body. And in fact, they're only a single layer thick. So they have a single cell layer, as we'll see in just a moment. Now, why is that important? Well, it turns out that capillaries are specialized blood vessels where we have the exchange of nutrients and waste products taking place between the cells, the tissues, and the organs of our body. And these capillaries actually connect the tiny arterioles to our tiny venules. So capillaries are very tiny blood vessels that are one cell layer thick. They contain a single layer of endothelial cells that is responsible for absorbing and secreting the nutrients and the waste products between the lumen of the capillary and the cells, the tissues found in close proximity to those capillaries. So arterioles connect to the venules via these capillaries. Now, hydrostatic pressure forces the cells of our body, and as blood travels, capillaries run close to the cells of our body, and when the blood travels through the lumen of the capillary, hydrostatic pressure basically forces the nutrients and our waste products to move back and forth between the lumen and the cells found around that capillary. Now, there are actually four ways by which the nutrients and waste products can be exchanged by the capillary. So let's discuss these four ways quickly. So this is the cross section of the capillary. This is the lumen of the capillary. And these are two cells that basically are found that create that capillary wall in the first place. We have these endothelial cells. Now, notice between these cells, we have two types of holes. We have a hole known as the intracellular cleft, and we also have a fenestration. And these two holes basically allow the movement of nutrients from one side to another side. So as the blood flows, that hydrostatic pressure pushes on our capillary that expands the holes and allows the movement of things across our wall of the capillary. So the first way is via the fenestrations. The second way is via the space between the cells, the intercellular clefts. Now, another method by which things actually are transported is via the cell membrane of these endothelial cells. So notice we have the nucleus shown in purple, we have the cell membrane, and just like anything else can travel across any other cell membrane, these cells can also actually transport things across the cell membrane. Now, the final method by which we can exchange nutrients and waste products is via the process of pinocytosis. doses. So this is simply when some type of molecule approaches the membrane of the cell essentially invaginates and it takes in that nutrient into our body and it creates a vesicle inside the cytoplasm that contains that nutrient. So these are the four ways by which there can be an exchange of nutrients and waste products inside the capillary between the lumen of the capillary and the surrounding cells, tissues, and organs of our body. So these are the three different blood vessels found inside our body. Arteries are very elastic, they have a high resistance, and they can recoil as a result of that thick layer of smooth muscle found in the tunica media, and they always carry blood away from the heart. Veins always carry blood to the heart, and unlike arteries, they have a thin layer of tunica media, a thin smooth muscle layer, and that makes them inelastic, they cannot recoil, and they can easily expand to carry more blood. And unlike these arteries, they actually have this valve system in place to basically prevent the movement of our blood back down that blood vessel.